Two men were on their way to a village called Emmaus. They were discussing disturbing events that occurred in Jerusalem when a stranger joined them and inquired of their conversation. They told him about Jesus being crucified and buried, and that some said that his body had been stolen, and others said that he had risen. When they got home, they ate together. The stranger broke bread, and their eyes were open, and they realized that this stranger was Jesus. Lord, open our eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart.
My name is Cheryl Pomfrey. My walk to Emmaus was 55 alive. I sit at the table of Austin Anna's, and I worship at Peace Baptist in Muggle. I'm the community spiritual director. I bring you greetings to let everyone know that my heart is with everybody as we go through this COVID-19. I wish we could be together, but right now we all need to be safe in the Lord, but I am praying for each and every one, and as well as the board of directors. May God bless y'all. May God keep y'all. May God blood stay over top of your clay body as well as your earthly home. Amen.
Hello, Rosalind Black, Birmingham Emmaus Walk number 32. I sat at the table of the amazing Annas, and I worship at Harvest Community Church. There are a few announcements that we wanted to make you guys aware of, so I'll go ahead and read those to you now. We had a fundraiser scheduled for the month of June, which has been postponed due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Also, the remaining two fall walks have also been postponed until our new year 2021. Further details will be presented to you later regarding that. We just wanted to let you know that we're going to be doing a fundraiser where you can pay either cash or through Venmo, whichever one suits you best. It will be for candle sales. The scents are lemon pound cake, clothesline linen, and volcano. We ask that you please purchase the candles as gifts or for yourself. More information will be available to you on our Facebook page as well. Any additional updates regarding fundraisers will also be available on our Facebook page. Again, I ask that you all stay encouraged. Please continue to practice social distancing and stay safe. Please keep connected with your local church. And until we meet again, I pray that God's will be done for you and your families. Blessings.
Oh, Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, cover us with your love.
Show us how to love each other as you love us.
Lord, teach us to be one, Father God, one as you and your Son are one.
Lord, when we hear division, help us preach unity and love.
Lord, help our churches to be examples of forgiveness and grace.
Lord, help us to keep the spirit of unity within the bond of peace.
Lord, heal our nation and allow each and every leader, whether it's on a national or local, to be able to be led by you.
Lord, comfort all the families who have lost loved ones in this coronavirus 19.
And Holy Spirit, we pray that you would be made big in each and every one of our lives.
Father, first show us if we have any part of disunity in any of our relationships.
Yes.
And lead us to heal those first. And then, Father, strengthen us that we may be part of unifying this nation, the body of Christ, and our neighbors.
Father, I pray that you would help us to examine our words and our thoughts before we say them. Lord, that we would think about each thing that we say before we let it come out of our mouths and think of it, how it's going to affect our brothers and sisters.
Father, I pray that we would consider others as more important than ourselves.
Yes.
Gracious God, I pray that you would cause understanding. Help us to stand or kneel, as the case may be, with our brothers and sisters in unity as your children.
Father, to remember that our opinions are not always right, are not always best. Help us to know that your opinion of all of us is that you love us as your children and want us to love each other.
And continue to remind us, Father God, that we are all your children as one, Father God, and that we must come together in the spirit of unity, God, to proclaim who you are and whose we are.
Lord, we think of these things as big events, but help us to see that each time we personally reach over a barrier, that we can help be the answer. Help us to do that.
Lord, show us how to build others up in your name and not be stumbling blocks.
Lord, you said that the world would know that we are Christians by our love, Lord, and we sing that with every walk. Sing that, Lord. Lord, help us to live out the same things that we're singing about. Help us to live those things out, Lord, and to be an example in front of those that we serve.
And Lord God, we just ask that you will open the eyes of our heart and that we will begin to see each other in your image and not based on anything else but your spirit living on the inside of us.
Lord, just comfort us when we do get around each other. Lord, let us realize that we need to love each other as our neighbors, like you loved us,
yeah,
in spite of anything. And dear Heavenly Father, let us realize that you see us on the mountain and we down in the valley. And so, Lord, we just ask that you continue to use each and every one of us in the valley for your will. It's not about us, but it's all about you.
And Father, open our eyes and open our ears to hear the people that need a comforting word, to see the people that need a comforting touch. Father, Help us to not be afraid to step out and be bold in the mighty name of Jesus.
Lord, I pray that you would bind the enemy's plan to cause confusion and to cause us to come against each other. Lord, I pray that you would bring peace and that we would have patience with each other and that we would always seek peace with one another.
Father, we ask even now, we ask now for a spirit of keen discernment that we be able to decipher the God thing from the good thing. Heavenly Father, we don't want to be caught, Father God, in being drawn to what is good as opposed to what is you, Father. So we are asking God to see beyond what is before us, to hear beyond what is said, and to feel, Father God, with your understanding right now, Heavenly Father, because we want to be aligned with your will and with your way, Heavenly Father, that we will put our hands to it and you will be able to bless it, Heavenly Father, with momentum and with progress, that your kingdom will be expanded in all of your
ways.
Lord, I just agree with all these prayers and we agree together. As pastors of Birmingham, ask Lord, the honor you've given us to serve your community. Help us to be servants of all the people, Lord. Show us what to do. Father, I pray as we, our community transitions into less of a personality-driven community, more of a Holy Spirit-driven community. Get us back to our roots. Get us back to the place where we started, where you birthed this ministry. With people together working, Father. We know you love unity, but you refuse uniformity. But we don't have to be alike to get along. But Lord, show us how to get along, even when we're different. We just thank you, Father, for all these things.
Yeah.
We ask you all these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Clap your hands, everybody. Let's lift our hands. Hello, God's people. It's a blessing and honor to be with you at this gathering and have the opportunity to share some of my thoughts and experiences in Emmaus. And I have to say, we're living in some fourth days. But these fourth days just helped me to remember that Emmaus was one of the catalysts that have prepared me for such a time as this. And I hope you feel the same way. Because, you know, when we join the Emmaus walks, we prepare with a purpose. And that purpose is to share how much God loves you. And we're passionate about people and getting them there so that they know that they can love themselves too. But more importantly than that, once they figure out that God loves them, they can love themselves, is that they can love others. And that's just the beauty of it. Because in John chapter 21, verse 12 through 17, Jesus is asking disciples after the resurrection, he's more specifically Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep. And so when I think about the love of God for us, for ourselves and for one another, I can't help but think about Emmaus. I can't help but think about the songs we sang about walking in unity and guarding each man's dignity. And saving each man's pride. I can't help but think about the opportunities that we have to engage with one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. And that the only colors we see are the colors of the rainbow and the covenant. So it is just a great honor that as we come together, we're reminded, because we've been prepared for such a time as this, to just apply those things that we have learned and are continuing to carry it on, and that we would do this. We would make a friend, be a friend, and bring a friend to Christ, because we need that for such a time as this. DeColores.
Dave, tell us about your upcoming walk and kind of what the status of your walk is.
Well, Mike, we postponed it till in the spring sometime, and I don't have the dates yet. And the next milestone that'll come up will be that team selection will reorient my walk. In the latter part of the year.
Okay.
And so that we can then restart the recruiting of everyone and setting up the walk, in by the March time frame, which is the date for the walk, but I don't know what the dates are yet.
Okay. Well, David, I know that there are a number of people in the community that would like an update on your health situation. So just tell us how we can be praying for you and praying for your health condition and just kind of give us an update.
Well, I had to restart the chemo back in February, maybe, you know, about in February, had to start new chemo, and I have to go once a week down to St. Vincent's, or actually the Bruno Cancer Center, and then I always have a catch-up day after that, and so forth. But it's as the doctor told me when he first diagnosed me, there'll be good days and there'll be bad days, and there'll be times the cancer's winning and there'll be cancers you're winning. So this is trying to reclaim the mean winning for a while instead of the cancer.
Okay. Well, David, this is a really, really good update. So your walk is going to be postponed until the spring walks of 2021. And do you have any final words that you'd like to give to the community about anything? Just a word of encouragement as we close out.
Well, I appreciate that they elected me to help lead the walk, and I really hope that by spring, that, or at least by 2021, that the coronavirus has tamped it down, because the reason that Walter Cash and I were interested in postponing it was we weren't smart enough to figure out a way to make it be like what we really thought that, and what we were led to think, a walk to Emmaus ought to look like. And it was one of the great times of my life. It changed my life. Mm-hmm. And so. Yeah.
Well, now, David, now we love you. We love you. We appreciate you. We're going to be praying for you. And thank you for your comments. We're going to include this on Thursday night's gathering. And again, thank you so much. I'm glad we were able to do it.
Hi, I am Tammy Gibbs, Birmingham Walk to Emmaus, walk number 65, Table of Anna, and I worship at Section and 5 United Methodist Churches. In September, the plan was to be Tammy Gibbs, lay director, walk 98. The circumstances created by the COVID-19 have caused the postponement of walk 98 from the fall of 2020 to the fall of 2021. How do I feel about that? Well, in a word, disappointed. What is this COVID-19 all about? Maybe COVID-19 is a consequence of living in our world, but isn't it something to see how connected we all are? The human race, God loves us all, everyone, worldwide, and He is with us. He loves us. He guides us. There is something I have heard over and over since about mid-March. We are all in this together. Everyone has been affected by COVID-19 in some way. Going forward, I do believe it is important for us to stay safe, be smart, and be aware of what is going on in our neighborhoods. I believe we need to listen and consider advice from our healthcare professionals. The planning and preparation for our Emmaus walks is a very prayerful process. God knows what we are going through. He is with us all, and He has a plan. To me, being a Christian is having faith in a personal God who covers and protects, a personal God I can worship and praise, a personal God who craves the relationship that I seek with Him. This is a time I can pray more and prepare myself for the upcoming walks. I'm called to love others. What can I do? I can focus on the basics. Prayer and scripture. I can rely on God in the good times and the not so good times. He is my strength. It's sometimes difficult to be patient, but I know God's timing is perfect. I truly believe that. Fall 2021 seems so far away, but I'll try to remember to follow God's pace. He is setting up everything and everyone for what is to happen for Walk 98. He will be the source of my renewal during this next year. My prayer for Walk 98 will continue, which is for God to stir the hearts of pilgrims who will attend, to prepare the hearts of the servants on the team, and for me to remember God is in control. Our God can work in mighty ways in people's lives. I may be disappointed in the decision to postpone the fall walks, but I certainly understand the reasons behind the decision. Because of COVID-19, we are in new categories of life: vulnerable, asymptomatic, comorbid, carrier, frontline worker, victim, families of victims, and we also have been quarantined on different levels for various reasons. Shelter at home, safe at home, safer at home, terms new to all of us due to COVID-19. They tell us these are unprecedented times, and it sure seems that way. Churches, agencies, companies, food service, so many people have come together for unity and helping with the hurting and the hungry. The power of God. God calls us to love one another. My family has had to find a new way to do many things, and we are coping. But there is one thing we all have in common. God is with all of us, and He has a plan. I look forward to the time to prepare for Walk 98 as God is continuing to prepare the pilgrims and the serve team. DeColores.
Hi, Emmaus friends. I'm Ken Simon, and I'd like to talk to you about sponsorship. So, if I can direct your attention to the fourth chapter of John, It's there where we meet Jesus at the well of Jacob on the edge of a Samaritan town. And he encountered a woman there who had had many husbands. And whether her relationships were rooted in a need for attention or a sense of low self-esteem, Jesus saw the deep thirst within her for a life of love, affirmation, and significance. So as they talked, the woman gradually began to recognize that he was a prophet. And Jesus in turn revealed himself to her as the Messiah. And at a key moment, he forgave her sins and offered her living waters, waters that would satisfy her thirst and enable her to worship in spirit and truth. The woman went back to town in gratitude and told others. She witnessed to others that a prophet, perhaps even the Christ, had arrived. And others responded by coming to the well to meet him themselves. And they too came to believe, not only because of the woman's testimony, but also because they had heard the truth for themselves. Well, the woman at the well is an image and model of Emmaus sponsorship. And her response to her encounter with Christ is precisely the kind of response that the Lord seeks from us. Out of gratitude for what he has done for us, he desires that we witness to others of the goodness of God. Out of love for others, his will is that we, in wisdom, consider sponsoring them on a walk. So our prayerful gift to others of the Emmaus weekend creates the opportunity for them to be brought to the source of eternal living waters and to worship in spirit and truth. Well, training is involved also, because Jesus didn't just recruit his disciples and then send them out into the world to preach the Gospels. He spent time with them and he taught them about the Father, about the Holy Spirit, about himself, about prayer, about the Word. You know, to properly serve others on an Emmaus weekend, we need training. We must spend time in preparation. Not only do we need to know how to sponsor a pilgrim, we also need to learn how to serve a meal, how to sweep a floor, how to clean a toilet, how to give a talk, how to lead a table, how to be quiet at a table. Obviously, we can't just show up at a walk and think we know enough to be an ALD. There's a process involved. And the first part of the process is to study. Study our training materials, attend training sessions, and attend team meetings. And from time to time, as you know, the community sponsors training sessions. So I strongly encourage you to attend these sessions and learn all about serving on a team. Well, the second part of the process involves the idea of progressive servanthood. That is, before you serve in one position, you first serve in other positions that prepare you to serve in positions that require greater levels of experience and involve greater levels of responsibility. And for that reason, we encourage lay people to serve on an outside team first. And then on the inside, you serve by leading a table or giving a talk and then moving up to be an ALD. Eventually, if you're called, you'll be prepared to lead a walk as the lay director of an Emmaus weekend. So it's a progressive, stair-step model of servanthood. So I encourage you to seek to work on a walk team or sponsor a friend on an Emmaus weekend. That's because many are thirsty. Many are hungry. So will you give them something to drink at the well? Will you tell others of the goodness of God and all that he has done for you? Well, Jesus wants to know. He's the Messiah. He's there at the well waiting for you and counting on you.
Well, praise God, saints. This is Pastor Mike Jones, Living Waters Walk number 19 and Birmingham Emmaus Walk number 1. I do want to greet you in Jesus' joy and welcome you again to our virtual Birmingham Emmaus June gathering here at Harvest Community Church. I'm going to share a very, very brief word, and then we're going to experience and celebrate Holy Communion in a virtual way. So if you'd like to put your device on pause and go get your own Holy Communion elements and be prepared for communion, that's fine. If you want to put it on pause when we get to that point, you can do that as well. But let's open up with a word of prayer and prepare our hearts tonight. Father God, we do thank you so much for this opportunity to come and to worship you as a community, to celebrate our oneness, to celebrate what you have done for us on the cross and what you are doing for us in our lives and what you will do for us in the future. Father, we thank you for your great goodness and your grace toward each one of us. We thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ has not lost its power. Father, cover us during this time. Bless us during this time. In Jesus' name, won't you say amen, amen, and amen. I want to share a very brief word about togetherness, And I'm going to read a passage of scripture in the book of Philippians. Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. Philippians 2, 1 through 11. And it says in verse 1, therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look not only for his own interests, but also for the interests of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, being in the form of a bondservant, and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Verse 9, therefore God has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. You know, the book of Philippians was written while Paul was in a jail cell. He wrote the book to encourage the Philippian believers, and many have called Philippians the book of joy because joy or rejoicing is mentioned over and over and over again, and the word sin is not mentioned in the whole Bible. However, the context of the book is written through the eyes of an incident in Philippians chapter 4. The beginning of Philippians chapter 4, there's a disagreement between two women in the church. And Paul encourages the Philippian believers to help these women with their disagreement, with their difficulty with one another. He says, help these women. So the backdrop of the book of Philippians is that there is disunity in the church, that they are not one like they're supposed to be. Let me ask you a question. What happens when we're disunified? What do you do in order to encourage unity? What do you do in order to encourage believers, brothers and sisters who are having difficulty with one another, how to get back and be one with one another? Well, I think the roadmap is right here in Philippians chapter 2. I think God gives us a word right here. And so I'd like to talk about the three things that will help us as a community and help us as believers if we find ourselves disunified and at odds with brothers or sisters in the body of Christ. Point number one is simply fight for unity. Fight for it. Notice what happens in verses 1 and 2. Paul says, therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, any affection of mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being one of one accord and one mind. He says, if it's worth it being a Christian, if it's worth it, Therefore, if there's any consolation in Christ, if Christ means anything to us, if there's any comfort of His love, if there is any fellowship of the Spirit, any affection of mercy, if it's worth it being a Christian, then fight for unity. He says, if that is the case, and it is the case that Christ is worthy, then He says, be like-minded, be of the same love, be of one accord and be of one mind. We have to fight for our unity. You know, we have an enemy that wants to separate us. We have an enemy that doesn't want us to be unified. Point number two, first is unity, but point number two is humility. Well, how do you become unified? Well, we've got to humble ourselves. Notice what it says in verse 3, let nothing be done through selfishness or ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each of you consider other people as more important than yourself. It goes on to say, let you not only look out for your own interests, but also the interests of others. Listen, if we want unity, there has to be mutual sacrifice. Letting down my issues, letting down my concerns, letting down my preferences, letting down my wants, letting down my opinions, and recognizing that you have them as well. And saying that I am not going to allow any issue or concern that comes across us to be more important than my relationship with God or my relationship with you. It's just not that deep. There is no concern that is too big for you to be out of relationship with your brother or your sister. Listen, the Lord has called us to fight, but He hasn't called us to fight with each other. He's called us to fight with the enemy. And men and women, let me just give you a word about Facebook. Every post does not need to be responded to. Every opinion does not need to be corrected. And every point of view does not need to be addressed. And men and women, there have been more fights on that social medium than I've seen in any other platform. And so let's be kind to one another. Let's respect one another. All of us come from different places. And so the places that we come from are reflected in the opinions that we have. So you may come from a different place than I do, and you may not understand where I'm from. And I may come from a different place from you, and I may not understand where you come. But you know what I can agree on? I can agree on that I love you in Jesus. I love you in Jesus, and I want relationship with you. So I'm willing to humble myself. It goes on to say that Jesus humbled Himself. It says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Jesus. Jesus left heaven to come down to earth, and He humbled Himself and became a servant. He became a servant. That was His mindset. And I want that to be my mindset. I want to serve you. I want to serve other folk. I don't have to be the top dog. I don't have to be the one who's listened to. I don't have to be the one who's respected. My role is to be a servant like my Lord Jesus. It says that He humbled Himself even to the point of death, even death on a cross. I wonder if I can humble myself to the point where I'm not even recognized. So unity, let's fight for it. Humility, let's be like Jesus. And then this whole idea of unity and humility comes from the fact that Jesus is sovereign. Unity, humility, and sovereignty. I've got to come to the point, if I want to be unified, that I know that it's not about me, but it doesn't stop there. It's not about me, it's all about Him. Any issue or concern is about Him. Any emphasis is about Him. Any spotlight is on Him. Any significance or meaning or purpose that I have in life comes from Him. It's all about Him. And I love verses 9 through 11, where Paul says about Jesus, Therefore God has highly exalted Him and given Him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth. And every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Therefore, God has highly exalted Him, not the issue. Therefore, God has highly exalted Him, not my opinion. Therefore, God has highly exalted Him, not my point of view. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. At the name of Jesus, not my name. At the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven, those on earth, and those under the earth. Every realm, at the name of Jesus, every knee is going to bow. And every tongue is going to confess that Jesus is Lord. My prayer is that Jesus would be Lord over Birmingham Emmaus community, that we would be so Holy Spirit driven and so Jesus driven that we're no longer concerned about who gets the credit. We're no longer concerned about who gets the spotlight, and we're no longer concerned about who gets the glory. Only Jesus gets the glory. That's my prayer for us, and I hope that that is your prayer as well. Let's pray before we enter into Holy Communion. Father God, we do thank you for this opportunity that we have for Holy Communion. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you would be glorified, that all of our sins would be forgiven. We thank you that they are in Jesus Christ. We remember your body that was on that cross for us. We remember your blood that was shed. And we pray that you would bless this table, that you would bless us as we receive. In Jesus' name, amen. I found a liturgy that is very similar to our Emmaus liturgy online, and I'm going to read it, and it should be on the screen for you as we enter into this time of Holy Communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of the faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours. Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. The body of Christ given for you. Amen. The blood of Christ given for you. Amen. Father God, we take this bread and ask that you would bless it. Father God, we pray and present this bread to you that represents your body. We ask, Lord Jesus, that you would bless it, that you would consecrate it, that you would set it apart, that as we receive, it would be to us a means of grace, the body of Christ broken for us. Amen. And likewise, we take the cup of the new covenant in your blood. We ask, Lord Jesus, that you would bless it, that you would consecrate it, that you would set it apart, that as we receive this juice that represents your blood, that to us it may be a means of grace. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take, eat, eat all of it." And likewise, he took the cup. He said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Take, drink, drink all of it." Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. God bless you. I hope that you've enjoyed our service. I pray that we would continue to struggle for unity, to practice humility, and make sure that we know that he is sovereign. In Jesus' name, let each person say, Amen.